We go. So welcome to our next Legal Education for Elders seminar series. Today's topic is what to do when your loved one gets sick or dies. And it's a wordy title, but it really just came from people that we speak with every day that had questions about these issues. And so we thought, what better way than to just have a seminar with a legal professional to talk about all of these issues that many of you may be dealing with if you're caring for a loved one. So I'm excited to present our speaker today, Marc, Managing Attorney with Acorn Law. Marc received his JD with honors from the George Washington University Law School. He's a certified specialist in estate planning, trust and probate law by the State Bar of California Board of Legal Specialization. He became an estate planning attorney because he wants to help families. He believes that with good planning, not only can future headache and expense be avoided, but you can leave a legacy for your family, taking care of them even after you're gone. And I know that's important to all of us. So I will go ahead and turn it over to Marc. Just know that you can use the Q&A to get your questions out there. So move your cursor on the screen and you'll see where it says Q&A, and you can chat your questions in as soon as you think of them. And then at the end of the presentation, I'll make sure that we address all of your questions, but go ahead and write them as soon as you think of them so you don't forget them. So thank you so much. I'll turn it over to you, Marc.
Great. Well, thank you very much, Martha. I'm glad I'm able to speak today. Thank you, everybody, for being here and listening to me. So let me go ahead and share my screen. Okay, I think that should be coming through okay. So as Martha said, our topic, what to do when a loved one gets sick or dies. So I have a colleague who says, we're going to have a lot of fun today. We're going to talk about death and dying, right? But hopefully you find this educational. We'll go over a few things that I want you to think about. Thank you very much for the kind introduction. You don't need to hear more about me. I'll just say this is what I focus on. This is my entire practice, working with families, both during significant health challenges as well as after death. And so doing good planning, it really is an area where an ounce of prevention is a pound of cure. And so I've dedicated my practice to it. So here's what we're going to talk about today. We're going to spend the first part talking about lifetime. So in particular, planning for a period of incapacity. So if there's a period during life where one spouse or a parent needs help and can't manage their finances or can't manage their healthcare anymore, what does that look like? And then how can the family step in and help them? We're also going to specifically talk about some risks there. Some of the things I see where families think things are set up correctly, but when the rubber meets the road, they actually aren't. One of them in particular, trusts. Probably many of you have heard of trusts living here in California, and many times thinking, oh, mom and dad have a trust, it's going to work. You know, will it actually work, and what all does that entail? We're also going to talk about long-term care. We're going to talk specifically about what are ways to pay for long-term care, and I'm going to spend most of that time talking about the two major government programs that are available to help pay for long-term care, which is Medi-Cal and VA benefits. So we're going to talk about those. Then the second part of our conversation today is going to be what happens after someone passes away. What does that process look like? How can we best plan for that? As well as what are some of the immediate steps to take, you know, in those first couple of weeks. I'm definitely going to make sure that we save enough time to take questions. So feel free to type them into the Q&A box. The Zoom will keep your question. I'm going to save the questions for our Q&A at the end, if that's okay. But I'll make sure we reserve at least 15, 20 minutes to take questions. So, all right. So let's talk about during lifetime. So what happens? What happens if you have a period where you're incapacitated? Now let's talk about what is incapacitated, right? Because that's not a black or white determination. Yes, a doctor might declare someone incapacitated. We might at times think our spouse is not thinking correctly, right? But that's not what legally I'm talking about. So let's start with this. who has the authority to make decisions for you while you're alive? And specifically, who gets to spend your money while you're alive? Well, that's you, right? If you're a sound mind, that's you're the one who gets to sign contracts, spend money, do things yourself. But what if you can't do that? What if there's a period, whether it's temporary or whether it's a permanent condition, where you can no longer manage your finances or you're not able to sign legal documents because you can't understand them? Then who does that? Well, government says somebody has to have that authority, right? Somebody has to be able to do that for you. Many times I work with couples where they think that because they're married, that's automatically their spouse, but that's not the case. There are some things a spouse can do, especially with joint accounts, but you very likely, if you've gone through this, run into a wall at some point where you realize being married does not necessarily give you the legal power to act for your husband or your wife. Especially if you've ever tried to call the insurance company or the credit card company and they say, put her on the phone, right? Or the mortgage company. So marriage does not automatically do it. So if you do planning ahead of time, you're able to select who you want to make legal and financial decisions for you. You also can select who you want to make medical decisions for you. And you do that through a number of legal documents, ones you've probably heard of, a trust, a power of attorney, or a durable power of attorney, and an advanced healthcare directive. So we're going to talk a little bit more about those, but those are the documents that you can create and do ahead of time to name somebody else to act for you. But what if you don't have these? It is possible that the planning isn't done ahead of time. What if you become incapacitated or your loved one becomes incapacitated and you haven't done, they have not signed a power of attorney or advanced directive? Well, if they truly are legally incapacitated, and I'm going to talk about that in just a minute, but if they're truly incapacitated, then the only option is what's called a conservatorship. This is called a guardianship in other states, but here in California, we call it a conservatorship. This is a court process where someone, a loved one, will petition the court and ask the court to be given the authority to act on behalf of the person who's disabled. So this is a petition to the probate court. Once a conservatorship is established, that person has duties and obligations to the court. And so depending on the powers given, usually though, there's ongoing reporting requirements for the remainder of that person's lifetime or until they get better and the disability is terminated and the conservatorship ends. Most of the time it's for the remainder of that person's lifetime. So there is court supervision in place, and that's to make sure, the court is looking out and trying to protect the conservatee, the person who's been conserved. So conservatorship sometimes is necessary. Now, let's talk a little bit about what incapacity is in terms of signing documents. Many times I meet with couples where there might already be a diagnosis that might indicate some amount of incapacity. There may already be a mild cognitive impairment diagnosis or dementia diagnosis, Parkinson's diagnosis. These are things we know they're progressive in nature, but that doesn't necessarily mean that we can't still sign legal documents, right? So the determination of whether someone has capacity to sign these documents is made by an attorney, not by a doctor. That's also a misconception. Many times doctors will write a letter saying someone does not have capacity, but they aren't necessarily speaking to the legal capacity. So it is important, especially if it's an early diagnosis with a progressive cognitive condition, that these documents get put in place as soon as possible, right? Because it is certainly possible it progresses to a point where we can't do them anymore, right? And we can't go back in time. So I did want to say though, sometimes I meet with people and they say, dad's already been diagnosed with dementia, he can't sign anything. Well, it depends, right? It depends where he's at in the progression of that disease. And also, some of these, like with dementia, there's good days and bad days, right? There's people that have sundowners, so it depends on, do we have moments of capacity too, right? So, working with an attorney who can help you really figure out, can we sign something? Or do we have to do a conservatorship? We can really look at that. But I do want to say not all hope is lost, even if there's already a diagnosis. Not always the case, but sometimes we can still do something. Let's talk next about some of the pitfalls I see in when people are we're dealing with a period of long-term care, and whether it's at incapacity or just physical challenges, you know, what are some of the problems that we run into, right? One of the biggest ones by far is seeing the families fight, right? Usually the kids over what's best for mom and dad, right? And where I see this happening a lot is when the conversations haven't happened, you know, where the kids, they're guessing now what it was mom would have wanted, what it was dad would have wanted, and they disagree, right? So I have those little kids up there. I have two little kids at home. I have two girls, but they do that a lot to each other. They're 4 and 7, you know, and it's kind of funny because you see some of these sibling relationships come back, even though, you know, we're talking about adults much later in age. So, you know, I say a lot of it comes from not having a plan, because we've gotten to a point where mom and dad can no longer communicate what it is they want, right? And so having these conversations, as you know, they're not fun to have, but having these conversations with typically the children, but whoever it is that would be stepping in and helping in these scenarios, having these and talking about these and coming up with a plan is really important, right? The power of attorney and the advance directive also go a long way, because in addition to providing the legal authority to somebody, they also designate a decision maker, right? So when decisions need to be made, you've decided this is the person whose judgment I trust, which leads me to another point, why families fight. A lot of times people want to name more than one power of attorney or more than one person on the advance directive. You can do that. There's nothing legally preventing you from naming co-agent, what are called co-agents, but that doesn't mean they need to make all the decisions together. And if they disagree, that can lead to a fight, right? That can lead to a problem, potentially court, right? So I usually recommend to our clients, you know, think about it. We can do it together, but especially on the financial side, it is much easier if you name just one person to be in charge, whose judgment you trust, right? Let's talk number two. This I hear a lot. Well, you know, I have a trust, or mom and dad have a trust. It's okay. You know, everything is good, right? You know, I have Macaulay Culkin up here, because Home Alone, anyone who's familiar with that movie, the way a trust works, and we're going to talk later about probate and why you create a trust to not be in probate, but the way a trust works is, think of it like a bucket. You create the bucket, and everything you own needs to be put in the bucket for it to work, for it to actually be effective during a period of incapacity. The assets need to be in the name of the trust. So a lot of times people go and have a trust created, and the trust, it's fine, but they never go through and do the homework and the steps of actually putting all the assets in the trust, right? So I have Home Alone up here because, you know, the plot of that movie is the family's rushing to go on this Christmas vacation, and they have 13 kids, and they get on the plane, and the mom sits down, and then her eyes pop open. Oh, Kevin, they realize, you know, they left their 6-year-old at home. And that happens a lot with trusts, right? Where assets are left out, and this is going to connect with the next pitfall we need to look out for. But very often, the trust itself, the document, is fine, looks good, but either accounts weren't put into the name of the trust when it was first created, or time has gone by, and the accounts that existed when the trust was first created are no longer the bank accounts you have now, right? That happens a lot. Also, refinancing the home, that can be a big one. Lender is supposed to take the house out of the trust, do the new loan, and put it back in the trust. That doesn't always happen. Sometimes they take it out of the trust and keep it out of the trust, right? So it is important to pay attention to and review, hey, are all the accounts titled the way they're supposed to be? Are they all in the trust? We'll talk about a couple other options besides trust and how to title accounts, but making sure everything is where it's supposed to be, right? Can't tell you how many trusts that come into my office where we still have old, you know, bank accounts like Washington Mutual and, you know, some Wachovia, some of these accounts, the banks that don't exist for having been around for a decade, right, or bought by other banks. And or where the house, you know, I saw one recently where the trust was done 23 years ago, and correctly, the house was put in the trust 23 years ago, but they refinanced back in 2007, and the lender took it out of the trust. And since 2007, the house has not been in their trust. They thought this whole time it's been in there, right? So it's important, especially when we're looking at incapacity. If we want these legal documents to work the way they're supposed to, that all of our assets are aligned and entitled properly in the trust. Like I said, another big problem is not updating the plan. So The average estate plan, they can have one in place, but the average plan is updated once every 17 years. So a lot can happen in 17 years, especially later in life. We want to look at, you know, the planning that's done when the kids are little is very different than the planning that's done after retirement, when maybe you're starting to have grandkids, which is very different than the priorities that may exist later when you're dealing with health issues, right, and long-term care challenges. So it's really important that the plan is revisited and updated as life goes on and as your situation and circumstances change, right? Especially, you know, one of the things that changes is the people you've chosen to step in, right? So many, many times I look at a trust and they're like, oh, we did it when the kids were little. So we named, you know, John's brother was named as a trustee. Well, John's brother's, you know, 88 years old now and lives in New York. You know, we want to name our son who lives out here and he's 30 something, right? And so many times we have the wrong people in the roles that we've designated, right? So reviewing the plan, knowing what it says, knowing who is supposed to fill what job is really important, and updating it for your current lifetime. And the fourth, this is a really big one. really big pitfall though is why do people not do it? They procrastinate, right? So this stuff's not fun to talk about. Paying money to a lawyer to create documents for you, not fun, right? I get it. And so, but you know, it really is important because unfortunately, this is one of those areas that if you wait too long, we can't go back in time, right? If there is a major health event or if someone passes, that's it, right? We can't fix things that weren't done ahead of time. So, you know, I encourage anyone looking at this thinking, yeah, I really should take a look at that trust and see what it says. Don't wait, take a look at it, you know, because we don't have crystal balls. You know, we all plan to wake up tomorrow and everything to be the same as it was today. But that's not always the case. So procrastination is a really big problem, you know, and it's important to take action in this area. All right. So that's on incapacity planning. We're going to talk about later in the second section about what happens after somebody passes. But now I want to talk about long-term care and talk specifically about a couple of the government programs that are available to help pay for long-term care and what the options are. So, and when I talk about long-term care, I'm talking about really everything that term covers. So that can be anything from, you know, in-home care to, you know, adult daycare programs to assisted living to boarding cares to skilled nursing, right? So just the whole range of types of long-term care programs, that's what we're talking about. So how do we pay for long-term care? Most people, their savings, right? That's where most people go, is they've saved up over their lifetime and they've, you know, they're able to tap what they've earned and accumulated during their lifetime to pay for long-term care. Second option is long-term care insurance. So if anyone in this presentation is watching this and still has an ability to get long-term care insurance, typically that stops being available around age 72 or so, depending on your health care or your health background. Certainly, I encourage all of my clients where that's an option to at least explore it, to take a look and see if that's something that fits the budget. Is there a way to get insurance? Because long-term care insurance can be very, very valuable later in life. So it doesn't mean it'll work, but if you are in a circumstance where it might be an option, at least look at it and see if that can fit. Especially because my favorite type of long-term care insurances, there are ones that have full return of premium, meaning basically, so I'll give you an example of a client. She had about $300,000 in the savings, just cash, you know, earning a little bit of interest in the bank. And we were able to, she was able to take that cash and put it into a long-term care policy where if she needs to get that money back, she can take it back at any time. It's 100% return of premium, meaning she can get back every dollar she put in if she needs to, just like as if it's sitting at the bank. But now she has long-term care insurance on top of that. I think she got up to about $700,000 of insurance, right? So there are some good options there, and it's certainly worth looking at. Also, a lot of my clients, if they don't really need to preserve the home for the children, a reverse mortgage can be a really good option, especially for being able to stay home and having in-home care. Reverse mortgages are good in that person who owns the home, whether it's if it's a couple or an individual, can never be forced to sell their house while they're there, no matter how long they live. So it can be a way, especially here in California, where there a lot of people have equity trapped, built up and trapped in their home. A reverse mortgage can be a good way to access some of that equity to pay for care. Reverse mortgages are typically designed as lines of credit. So instead of, giving you a big loan right up front and then charging you interest, it's like a home equity line where there's a line of credit that you can borrow against as needed to pay for care. So that can be a good option. The downside with a reverse mortgage, I think everyone's aware, is interest is being paid. You just don't see it. So it's eating away at the equity of the property the longer you live. So it's not a good option if preserving the home and letting it pass on to one of the children or someone else in the family is important. If that's an important part of your planning, a reverse mortgage doesn't really fit. But I'll give you an example. A client of mine, she had very, very little cash savings. And her spouse who had passed did not receive any, so they did not receive Social Security benefits. So she had very, very little cash flow coming in, but they paid off their home and their home was worth $800,000 and she wanted to stay home, right? And it was perfect. Then they didn't have children. So there was no need for her to preserve the home. She was able to access the money in the house, stay home, and was able to stay there for the rest of her life. The two that we'll talk a little bit more about are Medi-Cal. Medi-Cal and what Medi-Cal covers, and then certain VA benefits and what that covers. Importantly, Medicare. So Medicare is the health insurance that everybody over the age of 65 has access to. Medicare does not pay for long-term care, unfortunately. Medicare supplements do not pay for long-term care, typically. They will pay, Medicare will pay for a short-term period of long-term care. So after a hospitalization event, Medicare will pay for a short-term stay in a skilled nursing facility or a rehab facility. That can be 3 weeks. Typically, it's 20 days, 3 weeks. Sometimes it's up to 100 days, and sometimes the Medicare supplement will cover the copay on that. So it does pay for a short-term, but after 100 days, it doesn't pay at all. Medicare also does pay for in-home health services, so not caregiving services, but Medicare will pay for nurse, if you're recovering, for nurses to come to the home, for occupational therapists, for physical therapy. Medicare does cover that in the home, but it does not cover general caregiving services or long-term care. Also, I have this here. It's really important. Doing this and working with families going through long-term care situations, every single situation is different. What fits and is appropriate for your family and your situation is for your family and your situation, right? So nobody should really think, oh, well, my neighbor did this, or, my daughter's, or my daughter's mother-in-law had this situation. It's good to gather information, but really every single one of these situations is different. The healthcare prognosis is different. The goals and priorities of the family are different. The personalities in the family are different, right? So, nobody should feel that there's a right way to do it. There really isn't. It's a hard area to navigate. There's a lot of options, a lot of vocabulary, and it really is specific to your family about how to go through this. So let's talk about Medi-Cal and what that is. And there's a very big change coming up on January 1st of next year, which I'll share with you. But let's talk about Medi-Cal, or it's called Medicaid in every other state. We rebranded it here in California, but Medi-Cal. So these are a couple of myths out there, that Medi-Cal will take your home, or that you have to spend every penny you have before you can qualify for Medi-Cal. Matter of fact, you have to give away assets, or if you give assets away, there's a look back and you have to wait, 3 years or 5 years before you can qualify. They said there's a very big change in the rules, but even before the change in the rules, not all of these things were true. So let's talk about what it covers first. So Medi-Cal, there's really two big programs under Medi-Cal. One is community-based Medi-Cal programs, the biggest one being in-home support services, IHSS. That has an income limit. So your income does need to be below a certain amount to qualify for IHSS, and it has an asset limit. However, here's the big change. On January 1st of next year, Medi-Cal is doing away with the asset test, meaning no longer will they care how much money you have in the bank. They're only going to look at your income. So before January 1st of next year, we had to navigate these asset limits, and there were ways to do certain, you know, transfers and help people qualify. After January 1st of next year, there is no asset limit anymore for qualifying for Medi-Cal. There is still an income limit for that in-home support services, though. There is also another program called the Assisted Living Waiver Program. We don't have that here in Ventura County, but they do have it in LA County. That does help pay for assisted living costs. There are certain, the locations are limited and there is a pretty long waiting list, but that does exist. That also has an income limit to qualify. And then the other really big Medi-Cal program that they'll pay for is skilled nursing. So in a skilled nursing facility, if you're eligible for Medi-Cal, there is no income limit and no asset limit as of January 1st of next year, right? So the way that works is if somebody needs long-term skilled nursing care, that's in a skilled nursing facility or commonly called a nursing home, and they qualify for Medi-Cal, Medi-Cal will pay all that. They will take all of the income of the person there. Now I shouldn't say all, you're the minus $20. So you're allowed to keep $20 in what's called your personal needs allowance, but everything else goes towards the copay. If there is a spouse at home, right? So that's, if it's an individual, then they just simply take all the income. When it's a married couple and one spouse needs skilled nursing care, there are rules called the spousal impoverishment rules, which say that the spouse at home, it adjusts every year, but the current amount is about $3,800. So the spouse at home can keep all of their income. And if their income is less than approximately $3,800, they can also keep a portion of the spouse who's in the nursing home. They can keep some of their income to get them up to $3,800 a month. Right. So there's a minimum income that the spouse who's living in the home is entitled to, right? Even if their name isn't on the check. So that is something to be aware of when I say that all the income goes to the copay, there is an ability to shift some of the income from the spouse who's in the facility to the spouse at home if the spouse at home's income is below $3,800. Briefly, I'm not spending a lot of time on this because the asset limits are going away on January 1st. But generally speaking, your home is exempt. One car is exempt. IRAs are exempt as well. So home, car, and IRAs covers a lot. And that's about it. That's exempt. Right now, for a married couple, actually, these are a little outdated. Right now, for an individual, it's $130,000, and for a married couple, it's $190,000. But again, those are going away January 1st, so we don't really need to worry about exempt assets and countable resources anymore. So that's Medi-Cal. I should say on Medi-Cal and Medicaid in other states, very, very different in anywhere else in the country. So sometimes I have families that are thinking of moving to a different state where there's a cheaper cost of care, and that still may be a very good option. Just know that these rules that we just went over are very much California specific. In every other state, there's absolutely an asset limit, and it is $2,000 for an individual and $123,000 for a married couple, those numbers you have there. Also, every other state has a five-year look back, meaning you can't gift assets to qualify, or you can, but you need to wait 5 years. So just keep in mind, if the plan is to qualify for Medicaid outside of California, you're going to want to look into the rules of that state, and also what types of services are available, in-home support services for skilled nursing and assisted living. This is all very California specific, right? So other states have different services that are available. Many states cover assisted living in a more comprehensive fashion than California does, but again, it's a lot harder to qualify. So let's talk about the other major public benefit program, which is the VA aid in attendance. So this is a program available for wartime veterans, and I put the dates of service that are up there. So to qualify, you must have served at least 90 days of service, and 2 days of which were during one of these time periods I have up there, during World War II, Korean, or Vietnam War. don't need to be actually serving in the war zone, right? So you could, in the Korean War, if you were deployed to Germany during that time, that's okay, right? There, as long as the service occurred during these time periods, it qualifies. And then just need to have anything but a dishonorable discharge. So that's the service requirement to be a what's considered a wartime veteran for this benefit. For you also need to qualify medically. So there's three levels of this program. This program provides a monthly amount of money for both the veteran and the veteran's spouse. That's important. So these dates here, you can also qualify from the spouse's record. So if there's a widow whose spouse died, or if the couple is together and one spouse served, they both qualify for benefit. The spousal benefit's a little less than the benefit available to the veteran, but it qualifies for both. There's three levels, basic pension. Then there's one I don't have on here called homebound, and then there's aid of attendance. Really, we're trying to qualify for aid in attendance. That's the highest payment amount. Aid in attendance requires, it means that you require the assistance of someone else for the activities of daily living. So there's a form as part of the application that your doctor will complete that discusses your health conditions and what activities you need assistance with, right? Generally, they're looking for that you need at least need assistance with at least two of those activities of daily living to medically qualify for aid in attendance. Like I said, there's also a middle level called homebound, meaning you don't need help with activities of daily living, but you're otherwise homebound. Most people, like I said, we're typically going for aid in attendance since that's the higher amount that will be paid. Also, the amount that's paid before I go into the asset limits, the amount that is paid can be used for anything. So once qualified, can be used for anything. Meaning in-home care, assisted living, really any type of long-term care, that money can be used for, right? So much less restrictive or specific than the Medi-Cal programs once the money comes in. VA, just like Medicaid in other states, and Medi-Cal used to be, has both asset limits and income limits. On the asset side, the house is exempt, so that's good. One car is also exempt. There's a couple other small exemptions, like a prepaid burial plot, but really those are the two big ones. One key difference between the old Medi-Cal rules and VA aid in attendance, retirement accounts, so IRAs, 401ks, those are not exempt. Those count as resources, right? So you need to be below. On here, I say 80,000, but it's really 100. Well, I'll get to the next slide. That number is really 130,000, but it includes 1 year's worth of income, right? So it's really 130,000, but you have to count the income. I have in here, what if you have more than that? So this, they do also have a look back. You can't just give away assets. You can transfer assets, though. They have a 3-year look back. So it may make sense to make gifts of assets to trigger the look back, wait 3 years, and then apply for this benefit, right? So sometimes we do that when we're working with clients where we think, you know, there's a health condition where there's a high likelihood of long-term care need in the future, but also a pretty, you know, life expectancy is still pretty long. We'll look at doing some transfers potentially to the children and then waiting out that 3-year penalty period and then applying after. There are also income limits. Now the income limit for this is kind of funny. This is structured as a pension program, meaning the amount they pay is a minimum amount. And so let's take the amount for the veteran, we'll say $2,000 a month. If any amount of income you receive offsets that benefit dollar for dollar, right? Say, oh, okay, well, what's that worth? My Social Security exceeds, you know, the amount that I would get paid. The big deduction that you're allowed to take against your income is medical expenses. So for a lot of people, their assisted living, let's say the assisted living costs $5,000 a month, their pension and Social Security income is $3,500 a month. Well, for VA purposes, because their assisted living costs more than their income, they have zero income for VA purposes, or what's called IVAP, income for VA purposes. So they get the full pension benefit, right? When we're not looking at assisted living, when someone is still at home, many times if we're not spending that amount in caregiving services from outside the home, sometimes then if there's family members that are providing care, we can do what's called a family caregiver agreement, where basically we pay the family member, typically a child or whoever it is, we pay the family member just as if they were an outside caregiver. We pay them, and then the VA allows us to subtract that amount from income. And the goal is to get IVAP down to zero so you get the full benefit amount, right? So it can be really, really helpful. We just need to analyze it, take a look at the income, and then figure out what is that, what will that income look like, once the application goes in. I will say for the VA aid in attendance, the application, it's like a book. There's a lot of documentation that needs to be gathered. It takes the VA a little while to process the applications. If this is something that seems like, hey, this might benefit our family, it's good to get started and start doing the homework and gathering the necessary documentation and paperwork as soon as possible, because it does take a little while to get that application together. There are nonprofits out there that help people with putting together these applications. I don't typically recommend going to the VA office itself. They're not very helpful when putting these together. It is unfortunately a bit of an undertaking to put the application together. One very important document that you want to get your hands on as soon as possible, if this is something that you're looking at pursuing, is the DD-214, the discharge form, right? That shows the dates of service. If you don't have the DD-214 for the veteran, you can order it from the National Archives, but it does take them a little while to respond to those requests. So definitely, if this is something you're looking at, try to locate the DD-214 as one of the first things you're going to run down. All right. Let's see how we're doing on time. Perfect. Okay, so I'm going to talk. That's it for public benefits that can help pay for care, as well as dealing with a period of incapacity. Let's talk a little bit about what happens after someone passes away, and then I'm sure I'll have questions in this area as well. So I kept this section a little light because I knew I would get some questions, but let's talk about it. So let's first talk about probate. I think I mentioned probate court earlier. Probate, we've probably all heard of it at least. It's kind of a bad word by reputation. So what is probate? Probate is the court process that happens when someone passes away with nothing in place or if they have a will, right? So this is a really important distinction. Wills go through probate. All the forms that we attorneys file, the timeline, everything is the same, whether there's a will or whether there's nothing at all. The only difference is with a will, the court is enforcing the terms of the will, meaning the will can decide who the executor is and can decide how the estate is divided. But otherwise, it's the exact same process. Probate, I put the Ventura County average. In Ventura County, our court's a little more efficient than others. It typically takes us about 9 to 12 months to get through. LA County, about 12 to 18 months, right? So it can take longer elsewhere. Orange County is even longer than that. It's a court process. Which means everything's public. Some people don't like that. The biggest reason everyone wants to avoid probate, though, besides how long it takes, is it's very expensive. The attorney fees for the handling of probate are set by law, and it's a percentage of the estate, okay? Also, the person who serves as executor, which is typically a family member, typically a child, but that person is entitled to be paid the same amount the attorney gets paid, right? And I'll tell you, work on this. Sometimes I work with clients in the beginning, I say, and also you're entitled to compensation. In the beginning, they say, no, I'm not gonna take any compensation. We get about halfway in, they're like, this is a lot of work. And now my brother's being kind of a jerk. And you know what? I remember you said something about compensation, right? So I don't know that we can always count on someone not taking their compensation they're entitled to by law. To give any idea, I didn't put the table with these slides, but to give any idea of how much this cost is, if we take an average home in Ventura County here and just that, so let's take a house worth, call it $850,000. A probate is going to cost roughly $23,000 to $25,000 to go through. And then if the executor also takes compensation, it's going to be closer to $40,000 to take that house through the probate process, right? And also when calculating these fees, it's a percentage of the estate. And I gave that example as an $850,000 house. They don't count if there's a mortgage. The fee is calculated as if there is no mortgage and as if there are no debts, right? So it's on the gross estate. So you can have a house that's worth $850,000, but it has a $550,000 reverse mortgage. So now you have $300,000 of equity that's supposed to go to the kids, but it goes through probate. Of that $300,000, over $40,000 is going to go to legal fees and stuff that could have been avoided, right? So a big chunk. That's really why everyone wants to avoid probate. It's just really expensive. So how do we avoid probate? There's a bunch of different ways. I'll talk about the best way last, but to avoid probate, certainly joint tenancy. So this is the most common way married couples own their home in California, husband and wife as joint tenants. That means when one spouse passes, it automatically goes to the other person on title. Sometimes people will own property as joint tenants with their children. That is not a good idea. So even though we want to avoid probate, it is a terrible idea to add your children onto the deed to your house. The reason being, there's a couple. One is once someone goes on to title to your house, they're an owner of the property. You no longer have full control. So I had a client who called me very upset because she had added her son to her house, her only son, to her house 10 years earlier. And a joint tenancy because she didn't want it to go through probate. And now she wanted to borrow money against her house so that she could pay for caregivers in her home. And son was on title and he said, no, he refused to do it. And he would not agree to the loan. And he said, mom, that's my inheritance. And he made her move out of her own home into assisted living and he refused. So, you know that when you put someone, you may love your kids, but we just don't know how people, you know, sometimes they might start to think they know best. You give up control when you put someone on the deed to your house. Also, when you put someone on the deed to your house, their problems become your problems. So I had another client who called me, same deal. She owned a condo. She wanted to leave it to her niece. She was very close to, she didn't have children of her own. And put her niece on as a joint tenant onto her condo deed and was calling me very upset because her niece called her the day before to tell her she was filing bankruptcy, that she had gotten in over her head with debt and was filing bankruptcy. And now the aunt's condo was going to be part of that bankruptcy proceeding, right? So their problems become your problems. So definitely don't recommend joint tenancy for avoiding probate when passing on to anyone other than a spouse. With a spouse, it can make sense as long as you're comfortable with that house being owned solely by the surviving spouse, right? So the one place I don't recommend joint tenancy with the surviving spouse is blended families. If there's a concern that a new spouse, you know, the house might inadvertently not go to the children that it's supposed to go to, that can be a risk. And I'll share personally, let me just check time where I share a story. So how I got into estate planning. My grandmother and my step-grandfather, who she was married to for 40 years, she had two children on her side. He had six children on his. They owned their house up in San Jose, free and clear. It was about their only asset. They owned it like every married couple, joint tenants. She died. The house went to him. He drew up a will and died 6 months later, and he left the house to all of his six children and completely cut out my dad and my aunt, right? And so absolutely, and there was nothing they could do. I mean, it was, and that wasn't just bad planning. It wasn't really on purpose, but it was just because they did joint tenancy instead of better, more thoughtful planning. So as long as you're aware of the risks, though, it can be a good choice for married couples. Joint accounts, that's another way to avoid probate. You can vote certainly for married couples, but also if there's a small account that's kind of the everyday account that Social Security deposits and pension payments are coming into and bills are being paid out of, it can make a lot of sense to put one of the children on that account to help manage the bills. It's not the only way to do it, but that is a way to do it. We also avoid probate with pay on death beneficiaries or transfer on death beneficiaries. So many financial accounts, you can name beneficiaries for them to pass to. That can work as long as you're very diligent about it. Where I find problems with that method is sometimes the beneficiaries pass away before the account owner, right? And maybe the account owner is incapacitated and we can't change it now, right? And now we're in probate, even though there was a beneficiary. So I just finished a probate for an IRA 2 months ago because the IRA simply said to spouse as the primary beneficiary, but there was no secondary beneficiary. And so one spouse died, the other had advanced dementia, couldn't change anything. So when he died, the IRA unfortunately had no beneficiaries. We had to take it through probate, right? And that could have been easily avoided with just naming a secondary beneficiary earlier. For real estate, California does have a transfer on death deed. You might have heard of those. They're okay. They're still pretty new. The law creating those were passed in 2016. When they first came out, title companies hated them and would not insure title, so you couldn't do anything with a house for 3 years after death. They've gotten better on it. They still put typically a 6-month waiting period before the house can be sold after death, but they can be a way to transfer title to a house better than joint tenancy. Not always the best. It has the same problem with the beneficiary designations in that what if the person you named passes away before you? Now it's not doing us any good. Also, there are certain formalities that must be observed in creating and recording those, that if you miss one of the formalities, if you don't do it exactly right, then it's not going to be honored by the title company, and you're in probate. So I've really seen nothing but trouble with transfer on death deeds. They've not really worked the way they're supposed to in my experience, but they exist. They maybe one day they'll work correctly, but I don't typically recommend those. The last one and the thing I do recommend is a living trust centered estate plan. It's not the only document you need, but it is the best way to handle transferring property after death. It also helps, like I mentioned earlier, during managing things during a period of incapacity. Trusts are like wills, but they don't go through probate. The administration is all done privately. It lets you really spell out your wishes, exactly what you want to have happen. It deals with all the different contingencies in case people pass away. Now, very briefly, just checking time. So what happens after someone dies? What does the executor do? What should the family do? Right. So estate administration can generally be broken down into three stages. The first one is gathering control of all the assets and kind of telling everybody that you need to, both government agencies and heirs and beneficiaries, so notice. The second stage is paying debts, settling accounts, consolidating things down, filing final tax returns, getting everything ready for distribution. If we're going to sell real estate, typically that's when we sell the real estate. And then the last stage is making distributions, right? So sending out the checks. I put a few things to do immediately after someone passes here. I recommend requesting at least 5 death certificates from the funeral home. You might read online, sometimes people will request up to 10. This really depends on how many assets we're dealing with. We typically need 1 death certificate for each financial institution and 1 for each piece of real estate, right? So that can be a good, and 1 for the car. So I say minimum 5, but if you have a lot of financial accounts or multiple properties, you might want to go with 10 or more. You should also, if there are any pension payments being received by the person who passed, the decedent, the pension should be contacted right away. Social Security will stop automatically. The funeral home will contact them and let them know. So will Medicare. But pension plans, they will keep paying until you tell them. And then when you tell them, they'll show up with a bill and say, hey, give us all the money back, right? So it's best to notify them as soon as possible because otherwise we run the risk that the money comes into the account, it gets spent, and then the pension comes back later and says, wait, that wasn't your money. You need to give it back, right? And we don't want a situation like that. I also recommend contacting all the credit card companies, notifying them so that they close the account so nobody can steal, hopefully not steal any of the identity of someone who's passed, and do not use credit cards for someone who's passed away. That is not allowed. People do it on occasion, but I'm a lawyer. I got to tell you the law, don't do that. Also, comply with notice laws. This is a place people really get into trouble. When someone dies, there are government agencies as well as people in family members that must be notified by law. And if you don't do this, there are certain penalties. There are problems that can come up in the estate. It's very important that the first step includes noticing the people that are required to be noticed. And then we talked about probate. If a probate is needed, you still got to file the petition for probate and get that process started. I have here, this is a list of all the documents that go into an estate plan. These are really everything that should exist, trust, a will, a power of attorney, advance directive, and then a couple other things here. It's really those first 4 that are the really key. And I have the puzzle piece up here because these all work together. You really want all of these. If we're dealing with an estate that doesn't really have any assets in it, then you might only need a power of attorney and an advance healthcare directive. Those can be good for people that don't have any assets. But if there's a bank account, a house, definitely you need wills and a revocable trust. So, all right, I'm a little bit over, but I'm going to open it up for questions. Let's see. Okay.
Thank you so much. Oh my goodness. That was chock full of really good information. And I do want to let everybody know that Marc has offered to share the copies of the slides. So later this week, I will email everyone that registered a copy of the slides along with a link to view this recording. So if you need to go back and hear it again or share it with friends and families, you can do that. So that will be really helpful. We do have some questions.
Let me answer these. Also, I'll just add, I'll make sure when we send out the slides, I can put my contact info. I'm happy to chat with anybody and answer some questions. If you want to have a quick phone call with me, we don't charge you. Happy to answer some questions. And if you think something can benefit, happy to sit down and meet with you as well. If you think you need some planning, if it goes beyond a simple question and you might want an attorney, but if you have some short questions, happy to talk to you. So yeah,
that's amazing. Thank you. Yeah. Can you read the Q&A or do you want me to read them to you?
Yeah, no, I'll go ahead and read it. So okay. Let's see. Irene asked, do we work with special needs trusts and fiduciary services? Yes. So in my practice specifically, I do a fair amount of special needs planning. And so that is something that we can help with, both what are called third-party trusts and first-party trusts. So I'm certainly happy to talk to you about that. It's a little outside the scope of this presentation, but it is something we do, and I can talk to you about that. Special needs planning, so in case anyone's wondering, that's when we want to leave funds to someone who's disabled and receives government benefits as a result of that disability, like living in a group home, or because of their disability, they're not able to manage their own finances. So we want to make sure there's no disruption to their services. But yes, that's something that we do. And we have... Susan asks, let's see, if you don't have a trust but set up your bank and investments as beneficiaries accounts, if an individual is incapacitated, can the beneficiary ask the money if they're designated as financial power of attorney? So the fact that they're named as a beneficiary doesn't do anything while you're alive. So naming a beneficiary just gives them the money after you die. It doesn't do anything else besides that. But if you do a durable power of attorney and you name them as your agent under the power of attorney, then yes, they should be able to access the accounts. I will tell you, in practice, getting banks to honor powers of attorney is a hassle. I can tell you what the law says, but banks are private companies and they kind of have their own rules. So I've had on more than one occasion, I've threatened to take banks to court because they won't follow the law. So it's a lot easier when the accounts are in a trust to have somebody step in and access those funds versus using a power of attorney. That said, a power of attorney does work to access the funds. I have better luck with credit unions than banks, just for what it's worth. All the big banks are difficult to work with. In particular, I don't mind saying this in a public presentation, but really not a fan of U.S. Bank. Chase also makes things somewhat difficult. So, but all the big banks are not particularly easy to work with when it comes to powers of attorney, but it will work. All right. So Jean, okay. So Jean says, my brother has a trust. When I asked if he put his house and financial accounts into the trust, he said, no, they said I don't have to. I pressed, I said that he should, and he said they're covered. And he has a pour over will, but I don't really know what that does. And you're worried. You're right to be worried. So many times people create a trust, especially if they didn't work with an attorney and they went to a non-attorney service to get a trust. Non-attorney services are not allowed to give legal advice. So they'll say, oh, here's your trust. It's perfectly legally valid. And they won't say that anything is in it. If the trust has what's called a general assignment saying everything I own is in the trust, or it has a schedule of assets that lists the accounts, there's a process where we can avoid probate, but we still have to go to court and do something called a Hegstad petition, Heggstad, which we charge $5,000 plus filing fees to do. It's not plan A. It's not what we should do. It's why a big part of our process is making sure all the accounts and assets actually make it into the trust. But there are a lot of both non-attorney and law firms out there that simply create the trust documents, hand them to you and say, okay, you're good to go. And that is not the case. The only way a trust works correctly is if everything is put into the name of the trust. And you mentioned a pour over will. We always do a pour over will. A pour over will is something that you do when you have a trust that simply says, when I die, if I have anything I didn't put in my trust, put it in my trust. Which sounds great. That's exactly what we want. It pours over into the trust. The problem is it's a will. Wills go through probate. Now, if the assets are below $184,500 and there's no real estate, then yes, that pour over will sweep the accounts into the trust without having to go to court. But if the accounts exceed $184,500 Or if there's real estate, that pour over will just means you're going to probate. So why'd you do a trust to begin with, right? Okay, so but happy to, hopefully you can push him to really look at it, because it doesn't sound like things are set as they should be there. All right, Daniel asks, did I hear that you say long-term care insurance cannot be purchased after age 72? So Daniel, that's not, oh, yes, I can. Jean, there you go. There's a slide of documents. Sorry, Jean just asked if I could go back to this one for the list of documents you should typically see in a comprehensive estate plan. So Daniel, can you buy long-term care insurance after age 72? Yes, that's just a kind of rough rule of thumb where it starts to get really, really expensive after that point. It doesn't mean you shouldn't look into it. Certainly you can look at it, but just my experience tells me that after age 72, it starts to become prohibitively expensive and not worth doing, right? But that's not a hard and fast rule. An insurance company will sell you insurance if you pay them enough money, right? Regardless of the situation. So that's just a kind of rule of thumb where once you get to about age 72, it becomes difficult to find a policy that financially makes sense. So hopefully that's helpful. All right.
Well, I think you made it through all the questions at exactly 4 on the dot. So you get extra credit for that. Did someone just type something in?
One more.
Go ahead.
Here, I'll just answer this with Daniel. When an account is in the trust, does it have a specific name on the account? You should typically see either the name of the account statement. You're going to see either the name of the trust itself, or you'll see the words TR. You'll typically see that on the account statement. You won't see it on the mortgage statement. The mortgage itself is going to remain in the name. You mentioned the mortgage in particular. You'll see the mortgage itself will still be in the name of the person who took the mortgage out. But if you look at the property tax bill, that will show the trust ownership. If you're wondering about a house, you can also call our office. We're happy to pull the deed. We can take a look for you and tell you if a house is in the trust or not.
Wow. Okay. Thank you. This has been super helpful. I know that I've seen a lot of presentations on this general topic, but there's some really specifics that I'm taking away from this. So I'm hoping that everybody is. And I think when we go back and look at the slides, we'll find even more. We're doing this as part of our legal education seminar series. And our next one will be October 10th. That will be a fair housing workshop put on by the Housing Rights Center. So that is really, really important for renters or landlords to attend. And then in November on the 14th, we'll be having one presented by the Veterans Administration on VA benefits. So you gave a great overview there. And so if anybody wants a more in-depth presentation on that, then please register for that one. All of them are available to register on our website, seniorconcerns.org. Just go over to events and then seminars, and you'll see we have so much going on that page is getting very full. So take your time, because you might find some other things to sign up for. I know we have a few more questions coming in, but we will have to end. So I'll let you answer just what a trust deed is, because there seems to be a few people.
I just wrote one there. So trust transfer deed, that's just the deed which transfers the home into the trust. Or if there are rental properties, a deed transferring the rental properties into the trust. If you don't have a deed transferring the home into the trust, then after someone passes, we're going to either need to do a heg set if we can support that, which has its own expense, or that house is going to go through probate. I just met with the family 3 weeks ago. Trust was fine, power of attorney, advance directive, all the legal documents were fine, but mom and dad never signed a deed putting the house into the trust. They both passed away. And so now we're going through probate. They may as well not have had a trust at all, right? Mm-hmm. So very important.
So I think the key is it's really important to talk to a lawyer. It's really important to explain your individual situation and get the best guidance possible. So please reach out to Marc or call us and schedule legal concerns. Or if you already have an estate planning attorney, reach back out to them and do a check-in and make sure that you review all of this. So thank you everybody for attending. Thank you so much to Mr. Mackenzie for presenting to us today. I really appreciate your time and expertise. And everybody look out for an email from me in the next few days with the slides and the recording. So thank you all and have a wonderful evening.
Bye. Thank you.